Hello everyone and welcome to this meeting of the Licensing Subcommittee. Can I just do a microphone check with members to check that everyone's okay? The Chair, Councillor Banks?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yeah, that's fine. Councillor Walton?
Yeah, that's fine, Jane.
Councillor Kelly?
Yes, all okay.
Okay, can I just ask that when members aren't speaking that you turn your microphones off? Just to improve the quality of the sound for everybody else. Is that okay?
Yeah, fine.
Okay, hand over to you then, Chair.
Okay. Good afternoon, everybody. My name's Councillor Christine Banks, and I'll be chairing this committee this afternoon. I have Councillors Pauline Moulton and Councillors Malcolm just to make a decision today. So I've got a Ms. Ryan, is that right? And you say, what's your name? Your mic's off. Yes.
I didn't realise I was muted. My name's Craig Coley.
Okay, so you won't be speaking today, will you?
I may be asked to speak as I'm the current DPS for Allerton Manor.
Great, okay. Thank you for that. Okay, Anne-Marie, over to you. Your mic's gone. Put your mic on. Okay.
Still muted, Anne-Marie.
Sorry, I'll try again. The application today is for Allerton Park Golf Course in Allerton Road, Liverpool 18. The applicant is the Director of Allerton Golf Trading, who is Michael Hanlon. The DPS is Craig Bradfield Coley, and the application was received on the 25th of February 2020. And there's been a delay in the hearing, obviously because of the downtime for the pandemic, and then the retraining of officers to get us all online. So the general description of the premises is a golf course, clubhouse and function facility. And the summary of the proposed variation is to extend the areas of licensable activity to include golf course, enabling the use of a refreshment buggy to be used on the golf course, as well as allowing events to take place on an area directly outside of the clubhouse and sports bar on the practice putting green. Variations to the permit to permit the showing of films, which has now subsequently been removed from Craig Coley after the 28-day consultation period. Amendment of timing for outdoor activity of Sunday to Thursday, 10 a.m. to 2300, Friday and Saturday, 10 a.m. to midnight. Conditions have been agreed at Merseyside Police with regard to the use of polycarb vessels outside. The current licence is for live music indoors, Monday to Thursday, 11 to 11.59, Friday, 11 till 2, Saturday, 10 till 2, Sunday, 10 to 11.59. Recorded music is Sunday to Thursday, 7 till 01.00, Friday and Saturday, 07 to 02. Performance of dance, Sunday to Thursday, 11 to 11.59. Friday and Saturday, 11 to 0200. Entertainment of a similar description, Sunday to Thursday, 10 to 0100. Friday and Saturday, 10 to 0200. Late night refreshment, Sunday to Thursday, 11 till 1. Friday and Saturday, 11 till 2. Sale of alcohol, Sunday to Thursday, 10 till 1. And Friday and Saturday, 10 till 2. With the opening hours of Sunday, Monday to Sunday, 7 in the morning till 2. There are 10 representations being made to the committee and one petition with 12 signatures. And just one amendment for the committee report, Chair, that item E at the back of the committee report makes reference to a cumulative impact policy, and that's just been a clerical error on my part. If you can remove that from the report, please. Thank you.
Thanks for that, Anne-Marie. I'm going to invite you now, Ms. Is it Ms. Ryan or Mrs. Ryan? Put your mic on. Mic on. So you're Ms. Ryan.
It's Ms. Ryan, madam. Yes.
Okay, over to you, Ms. Ryan.
Madam Chair, members, I'm Ms. Ryan, I'm a solicitor from Hill Dickinson, and I appear today on behalf of the applicant. Allerton Park Golf Course. Accompanying me today, as you're aware, is Craig Coley, who is the Group Operations Manager and also the Designated Premises Supervisor. As you've heard from the Licensing Officer, is an application for the variation of the existing licence held by Allerton Park Golf Course. Just the point of clarification, I just wish to confirm that with members, that my client doesn't seek to pursue the application for the showing of film. It is something that's come about as a consultation, which I think will become clear during the course of the afternoon. Allerton Park Golf Course is a community hub. It is run by a responsible and a very significant local business. It's operated in partnership with Liverpool City Council. The course is open both to members and to the public on a pay-as-you-play basis. It's an 18-hole championship golf course and it's set within the Allerton Manor Estate. In addition to the course, the clubhouse also has a ground floor restaurant, the Stables, which also has a heated terrace, which accommodates up to 100 guests. And on the first floor, there's a hayloft, which is a private function suite, which is used for the holding of weddings, christenings and other celebrations. The premises have parking facilities for 100 cars, but has the facility to provide an overflow, increasing capacity to 300. The application has been considered by each of the responsible authorities, and they recognise that the existing conditions, which are already contained in the operating schedule, and that they are relevant and proportionate conditions, which would effectively promote licence objectives, and therefore no objections have been raised. Of course, in determining the application today, you will have regard to the Licensing Act 2003, the relevant government guidance and your own licensing policy. Madam Chair and members, you will no doubt be aware that it is only those objectives which must be the focus of your consideration, and matters which are not relevant to the licensing objectives must be disregarded. You should also consider matters that are within the control of the license holder. The view, in contrast to the view that's been taken by the responsible authorities, as you've heard from your licensing officer, there have been a number of objections to this application. There is, as you've heard, 10 objections from local residents and a petition containing 12 signatures. Madam Chair, members, I'm hoping that you've had sight of an email and letter, correspondence between Craig Coley and the Sister Patricia of the Carmelite Monastery. Have you had an opportunity to view that? You will note from that documentation that Mr. Coley, as Designated Premises Supervisor, has sought to reach out to the Carmelite Monastery, they being the nearest neighbours, and to invite her to a meeting to discuss her representation and the concerns that the monastery have. The intention was that that invitation would have been extended to all persons who've made relevant representations. Regrettably, due to the global pandemic, it hasn't been possible to facilitate that. And obviously, Mr. Coley hasn't had the email details of each individual objector. So it is regrettable. But can I say that certainly the applicant's intention is that they are hopeful to maintain cordial relationships with the local community and with near neighbours. And Mr. Coley, who you will hear from shortly, certainly is anxious to address any concerns that any local resident or any person who has any concern with the premises may raise.
Chair, can I just pause in? We seem to have lost Malcolm. So we might have to pause the meeting and try to get him back on. Just let me. Give me 2 minutes.
Sorry, ma'am, you're muted. Madam Chair, I can't hear you.
Is that okay with you?
Yes,
while we wait.
Yes,
I'm absolutely fine. I think I'll just have to unmute us. You were there a second. You've been in the lobby.
just tried to, I've just phoned him. He's just trying to get the connection back. He lost the connection. So give him a minute.
Okay, I'm going to bring Miss Ryan back in. And in the last communications, we've spoken to the nuns. So, Miss Ryan, over to you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Madam Chair, members, obviously you've heard that there have been a number of relevant representations made in respect of this application. And if I may just briefly address a few of those grounds. The first of which to bring to your attention is an objection on the basis that have been attempted break-ins in the local area. Clearly, there's no evidence before the subcommittee that there's any nexus between the applicant's premises and any alleged criminality. That's a representation based wholly on supposition, and I would invite you to disregard that. Similar comments in terms of news, traffic and highways issues, that there's been reference to taxi routes and parking considerations. Unless those matters are directly to the question of public safety, particularly in respect of the traffic matters, again, I would respectfully submit that that's something which you should disregard when considering your deliberations. In respect of the parking issues, I had previously indicated, members, that there is a capacity of 100 parking spaces at the premises, and there is sufficient land for an overflow of up to 300 visitors for attending events or private functions. And there's no cogent evidence that any of those issues that have been described by the objectors actually relate directly to Allerton Park Golf Course. There is a considerable driveway. There's reference to various roads in the Allerton area, but certainly there's nobody who's been observed exiting intoxicated from the premises. So again, I would respectfully invite you to disregard those as, again, being based on supposition. In respect of safeguarding and the protection of children from harm, clearly there hasn't been any relevant representation made by the safeguarding team. And as you may be aware, in terms of the licence, my client operates the Challenge 25 policy in any event and takes that responsibility extremely seriously. In respect of the events which are referred to within the representations, those being referred to as an unannounced party, there were two events which I will invite Mr. Coley to address you upon in a moment. One of those being a celebration of life for a club member conducted under a temporary event notice, and the other one, it was a charity, children's charity event described, I think, on the temporary event email you've seen as a children's disco. But Mr. Coley will be able to assist the committee with further information in relation to those events. Members, I would respectfully submit that the representations lack an appreciation of the intention of the club. The application to vary the licence is for the purposes of allowing individuals, rather than ceasing their game of golf, to use the existing refreshment facilities, to allow the flow of play across the course and to extend the offering using a mobile bar cart to provide a drink and some food during the day and during the game, which is in play. It isn't a dramatic alteration to the way the premises are run now. There is alcohol available at the relevant times. There is food available at the relevant times. The distinction is that it will be available to players on the course, and it would allow freer flow through the golf course and ultimately greater availability of games to other course users. And that is something that the business, and they are a business, are keen to ensure happens. We are in a global pandemic, as you are no doubt aware. There are huge pressures on businesses to look for novel and innovative ways of developing the offering that they currently have. And this would provide an opportunity to provide an extra dimension to Allerton Park's offering. They have corporate days currently, but they are relatively small in number, and it's just a further cachet that you can place on your advertising, attractive to corporate events. And that is the thinking behind that aspect of the application. It's certainly not the intention that the bar cart will be roaming around the outer limits of the golf course at 11 o'clock at night. I think Mr. Coley will explain the thought process in respect to the bar cart is it's likely to be retired at about 6 p.m. when most play will have concluded. The request for the remaining outside space is actually focused largely on the putting green and the area outside the stable restaurant. Previously, that area has been the subject of temporary event notices for the funeral, which I've previously mentioned, that was held in a marquee, the Champions League event, the screening of the match, which has been made reference to in the representation. And the intention is that that area would be used for those type of events and events ancillary to the golf, so live golf prize presentations, for example. So it is simply to extend the offering. But perhaps, members, at this stage, it would be appropriate for me to introduce Mr. Coley, who is as the designated premises supervisor, to provide you with a bit more background. So, Craig, let's see if I can pass it over to you at this stage.
Thank you very much. Madam Chair, members, I'm Craig Coley. I'm the DPS at Allerton Manor, and I have been for the 4 years since the Old Stables restaurant first opened there. And I've been there through all the various changes and developments that have happened at Allerton Manor. If I just give you a bit of a brief background in terms from a license point of view, you know, I think some of you may be familiar with Allerton Manor and the type of venue that we are. We're not your high street bar or anything like that. Our main goal and vision has always been at Allerton Manor to make it a family-friendly leisure destination set in South Liverpool, and to attract sort of the young family and local residents that live sort of within the Allerton area. We've also made reference to, we've got the function suite there to allow to accommodate sort of weddings, funerals, christenings, etc. there. In terms of the licensing side of it, I've been there 4 years, as mentioned before. We've had four previous temporary event notices for various events that we've held there. One of those temporary event notices actually never took place in the end, it was cancelled last minute. However, the other three all went ahead. And obviously during those times there, we had an obligation to make sure that we upheld all the licensing objectives during that time. And never received any negative feedback on the back of that from the likes of environmental health or the police or anything like that. Now, in each of those circumstances that we have had events, I'm sure the licensing officer will be able to confirm this, we have always taken every precaution to make sure that we are working within the licensing laws, and I've consulted with Paul Kelly from Environmental Health, as well as Craig Carmichael from Merseyside Police, and Anne-Marie Moran from Licensing, to make sure that we were doing things in the correct manner. And we've always taken precaution to make sure that in these events are carried out, there's minimal disruption to the local community in the local area. In terms of what we currently offer there, you know, I've read in the objections about people sporting onto the streets and causing nuisance to local neighbours and things like that. The type of clientele that we get at Allerton Manor, as I said before, is not a high street bar. It's young families. There's a fair amount of the older generation there as well. It's a very sensible clientele. And in the 4 years I've been there, we've never had to call on the police to intervene in incidences that relate to alcohol or any events or anything like that going on the premises. So, you know, that kind of gives you a little background as to what we do. And, you know, we were always willing to work with the local community and authority to make sure, you know, there's less disruption to them. The reasoning behind our variation application today, from our point of view, is we found over the 4 years that there's a few little tweaks and changes that have come up that we would be useful for us to have, which is where the tweaks to the timings and the event spaces come in. But in particular, the core reason for us applying for this variation is to enable this drinks buggy on the golf course. As Ms. Ryan's already said, it's not there to increase our footfall to Allerton Manor, but rather enhance the offering that we currently have on site for our clientele. The drinks bag itself will only operate during playing hours, which generally is daylight hours, retiring at about 6 o'clock during the summer and even earlier during the winter, at which point, you know, we would only be carrying our licensable activity within the main clubhouse buildings and the areas directly in front of the terraces and areas that are currently licensed at the moment. So hopefully that sort of kind of clarifies our position where we've come from on that front, if anybody's got any questions for me on that.
Okay, Mr. Cowley. I'm going to bring in the councillors. So does anybody want to speak first? Raise your hand. Malcolm first. Is that okay with you, Pauline?
Yeah, that's fine.
Malcolm, bring you in.
Thanks, Chair. First of all, you know, my apologies for the technical problems I encountered there. I don't quite know what went on there with my connection, but anyway, we're back up and running now. Just a couple of questions. Obviously, the one of the complaints, and it's already been alluded to, refers to some outdoor party events. They're talking about unannounced events, and obviously that's all been explained. But has the golf club received any complaints directly from local residents, or was anything specific relating to these incidents that have been talked about in the objections? Have any complaints been received from residents directly regarding those?
Jeff, I can answer that. I don't have to record of any complaints direct to ourselves. We did receive two complaints after the kids event that took place, I think it was back in August last year, via the environmental health officer through Paul Kelly. Now, when you actually look at the details of those complaints that received at the time, they referred to this event going on past midnight and being very loud, etc. Now, we have started to monitor the sound levels when we host such events to make sure that we're not exceeding the 65 decibel limit at the nearest residence. But also in addition to that, that particular event only went on between the hours of 4:30 in the afternoon and 8:30 in the evening. And by 9 o'clock, the event was shut down and all the kids attending the event were off site by that time. And that was something that was agreed on strict condition with both the licensing officer and safeguarding and the event organizers as well. So the complaints that were received weren't reflective of what actually happened on the day of that. But in terms of the other events and the other temporary event notices, no complaints were received directly to ourselves.
So, for instance, obviously they're not named, the complainants, but there's I think it's on page 6 of the committee documents, there's a complaint there which refers to music blaring until 11 o'clock at night. Is that the same event that you're talking about in terms of the kids' party?
Yeah, I believe so. So I'm just double checking I'm on the right one that you're referring to there. In terms of that, yeah, the only one where there was a loud noise as such that was complained about that I'm referring to, the other events that we had, the music certainly didn't go on past 11 o'clock at night, given that was our current license condition. And second of all, I personally, you know, patrolled the outside areas and went to all the closest residents on all sides of the golf course and measured the readings. And at no point did we have a reading above 60 decibels, which is obviously below the 65 decibel limit. And, you know, it certainly wasn't as loud. And as I said, I think that's referring to the kids event there, whereby obviously that finished at 8:30 on the dot.
Okay. Yes, yeah, thank you.
Pauline, did you want to come in?
Yes, please, Chris. you're saying about using the extending the license to use the putting green outside the stable area. What sort of things are you looking to put on there?
To be honest, this is this can vary a little bit in terms of, you know, we, for example, last year we hosted an event for the Champions League final, which, you know, after I think this season, it could happen again next year, we don't know. So it could be things like that. We hosted a funeral on there in the past. I thought it was a larger funeral that wouldn't fit in our main function suite, so a marquee was erected on the putting green. We can hold golf prize presentation evenings on there, as well as if we host corporate golf days, they tend to have sort of an area where they'll have a bit of a presentation in the evening and, you know, a bit of a social mingling, as it were. And that's sort of events that we'd aim for. It also depends if a client approaches us wanting a particular type of event on there.
Yeah, well, I suppose the point I'm trying to get to is that the type of events that you've held have sort of been reasonably early finishing, say 11 o'clock-ish. But if somebody came along to you and wanted to have a wedding reception in a marquee on your putting green, then obviously they're going to be looking for, you know, to be drinking a lot later, shall we say, which then could have an impact on neighbours. And that's where I'm sort of coming from.
Yeah, I appreciate that. As we put in the application, you know, we certainly don't want to be going past midnight on a Friday or a Saturday night, given that we understand this can have an implication against the local residents and the local community. At the end of the day, we do understand that we are in a residential area within Liverpool. So, you know, we've got to respect our neighbours to that degree. I'd say from our side, even if that was the case and they did want to have an event on till midnight the latest, then, you know, that certainly would be managed on our behalf to minimise the impact to the local residents, as we have done for such events like the Champions League, you know, where we've implemented things such as, if I give you an example, for Champions League, we had the event going on late. We knew there was going to be an issue come 11 o'clock where we had to shut the event down, but we're going to have, you know, X hundred of people on site. So we even hired a coach ourselves to ferry people down into Allerton Road, onto the taxi ranks, things so that they could find a safe passage home. You know, we would have to manage that on an individual basis, depending on what events came up. And if it was a particularly large event, then I would take advice, as I have done in the past, from the likes of Paul Kelly or Craig Carmichael, or even the licensing officer.
Okay, thank you.
So, going back to you know, the area where you have these events, is it by the clubhouse?
Yes, it is. If the members would like, I do have a map of Google Maps on my screen that I could share with you, and I could just point out that exact area to familiarise yourself with it if you like.
And then how, are the residents further away? Because it is a golf course. So is it in the middle of the golf course? Because I'm not familiar with this.
Is it, yeah,
in the middle,
it is.
Or the edge or the back?
Yeah. Have the members all seen the map that was handed out with that? Okay. If you do, does anybody have that available with them at the moment? And I can just sort of point out exactly what the area is.
You got that, Jane?
Right. That one.
Yeah. So currently at the moment, the blue hashed out areas on this map are those are excluded from the application because that land does not is not part of our boundary. Okay. So if we were to look at the small square in the middle of the map that's hashed out, just to the left of that, we have the two main buildings of you know, the old stables and the sports bar. Now, the areas that we host the events are held in that area directly in front of those buildings, surrounded by that tree line, which is the line going down the left-hand side and sort of like a big sort of curve around there. So it's in between the buildings, and essentially that tree line is where we host the events.
Okay. Thanks for that, Jane. Are you okay with that, Malcolm and Pauline?
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah. Thanks.
Okay. You know your buggy? I'm trying to get this in my head here. It's a buggy, it's a bar buggy, isn't it?
So what it actually is it's basically a golf cart, and on the back it's got a big cooler box, which we use at the moment, and it distributes soft drinks and food as well. So it offers sandwiches, bacon, butties, things like that on the course. And the purpose of application is us to simply be able to offer things like bottled beer, etc. on it as well.
Okay, thanks for that. It's trying to get it into my head. You said you've had no complaints, or other than maybe one when you'd had the Liverpool game on. And then you said you bused people from the house, the clubhouse, to where the taxi ranks were. Is that what you said?
Yes, correct. So on that night there, just to let you know what precautions we took from that is we had hired a big double-decker bus. And then as soon as the final whistle went, we started ferrying people down to Allerton Road to the bus stops there. And it kept doing trips essentially until there was nobody left on site. We then even, there was a large number of people at the end who wanted to go further into town. So we even paid the driver extra that night to take those people all the way into the city centre so they could go continue their celebrations. In addition to that, on that night, we hired in 14 SIA trained doormen who as well, when the game finished, we had them actually positioned at the end of the drive. So we could control the flow of taxis, and if people did decide to walk down to the road, we could manage those people as well to make sure they weren't causing disturbance.
Oh, thank you for that. I'm going to Paul, do you have any questions? Paul Merriman? Where is he?
Can you hear me?
Yes. Have you got any questions, Paul?
Yeah, just a few of them, mate. The buggy, in one of the representations, the concerns that's raised is that to have a mobile service would put alcohol within 10 to 20 meters of a family home. I wonder what you'd say about that.
To be honest, I'll be completely honest, I don't quite understand what the concern would be in terms of we, as a responsible licensed premises, would obviously operate that vehicle responsibly. And obviously everybody that works with alcohol within our business is licensed trained as well. They understand the rules of Challenge 25. They understand the rules of not selling to drunk people, etc. And there seems to be a bit of a perception that this buggy we're basically going to go out and we're going to try and get all the golfers as drunk as possible on the course. That is not the case in this instance. If you consider a golf buggy, the time, essentially how it works is it starts on hole one and it starts driving around the course, and it literally goes hole by hole all around the course and does a few laps during the course of the day. And any golfers on the way can stop the buggy, flag it down, say, yeah, I would like a drink, and I get a drink. So in theory, the average golfer will probably only see that buggy maybe twice while they're playing their round of golf, or constantly on the move and operate responsibly. To a degree, in my opinion, I don't see how it poses more of a threat than if your next-door neighbor was having a barbecue and having a few beers, if I'm completely honest. But, as I say, we will operate that in a responsible manner as we would if they were in the clubhouse having alcohol.
Thank you. Does that sort of answer
your question?
Thank you. There's also concerns that people and families and children could be exposed to the sale of alcohol by enjoying the public footways. The public footpaths that run through the golf course, and I wonder what you have to say about that.
Yes, certainly. Are you quite familiar with the site yourself? Do you know the footpaths and how they run across the course, etc.?
No,
or
No, I'm afraid not.
Okay. If you don't mind, can we have another look at that map again? And I can just point out exactly where those piles are and it just explain a bit more about the layout of the course and how it will separate it from that. Okay. So currently at the moment, there's one main footpath that cuts across our golf course. So if you were to look at the entrance at the top left of the picture there, the public right-of-way actually runs up along that line and then turns right and comes down the page behind the clubhouses, down its own path, almost through like a bit of a forest, all the way down until it crosses out and comes out at the bottom of the page. The road that turns off immediately towards the blue hatched area is not a public right of way. That is our course maintenance road within the course and is not a public footpath. Now, that road essentially actually divides our site into two sides. So the right-hand side is the 18-hole golf course, is all completely on that side, and the left-hand side is the 9-hole golf course. So in terms of the drinks buggy, there's only one point where it would actually cross over that footpath and come close to it, as it were, as it would start going around the 18-hole golf course, up and down the holes on that side, and then essentially cross over that path there to the 9-hole golf course, and would continue to circulate on that area. So in my opinion, it would stay well clear of that public right-of-way, and we're well aware it's public right-of-way, so we wouldn't, it would be outside the jurisdiction of our license, and therefore we wouldn't be doing any sales on that path.
Thank you.
Thanks, Jane. Do you have any more questions, Paul?
Just one if I may, Chair. You've described the area, the additional area that you're seeking permission for, as focused largely on the putting green and the area outside the stables restaurant. Is that correct?
Yeah. Sorry, that is correct.
So how, in respect of those areas, because I don't know how familiar members are specifically with the site, how close do you say the nearest residential accommodation is to those areas?
To those areas specifically, I would say it would be the Carmelite Monastery, and I would say that it's about, 150 metres.
200 to 250 metres.
Correct, yeah. I did used to know that measurement off the top of my head, but I don't know what it is at the moment, but I believe
it's... Are you able to say how close the nearest residential accommodation would be?
Further than that, I would say in the region of about 200 to 250 metres.
Thank you. That's really helpful. Thank you. Thank you, Chair.
Okay.
Thanks, Chair.
Okay. There's no more questions. Well, go on. Jane?
Wasn't me.
Oh, okay. Okay. So there's no more questions. And I'm going to go to Ms. Ryan to sum up. Is that okay with everybody? Over to you, Ms. Ryan.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Well, members, as you've heard from Mr. Coley, I hope that you are satisfied, as certainly I have been, as to the responsibility that he takes very seriously as designated premises supervisor, and that this is a reasoned and responsible operation. It is well run. You've heard the additional layer that the business put when running events at a cost to themselves to ensure the safety of customers attending at the licensed premises. You heard, as Mr. Coley described, in respect of the Champions League event, and going that step beyond to convey guests not only to the edge of the premises, but beyond, and indeed onto Liverpool City Centre. And that is, in my respectful submission, an indication of how this business is run. It is run responsibly. It is run having had regard to upholding the licensing conditions. It is not a business
which is likely to be allowing customers who visit the premises and who benefit from licensed club activities to be staggering down the driveway and out into the local area and causing noise, nuisance, disturbance and engaging in criminality. It's certainly not the position that, Mr. Coley is describing. I would respectfully submit that, having heard how well this premises is run, it's a local business. Mr. Coley, through his actions in contacting Sister Patricia at the Carmelite Monastery, has shown cogent evidence, I would submit, of a genuine desire to maintain cordial relationships with nearby residents and to listen to concerns and to adapt behaviour accordingly. You've heard the application that there hasn't been any representations from the responsible authorities. You've heard the plan for the purpose behind the variation and the nature of events that the B licensed premises are seeking to hold were this variation to be granted. And in my respectful submission, they are all reasonable and proportionate, and they don't put the premises at risk of causing harm to the licensing objectives. With that said, I would hope that, taking on board the robust operating schedule that exists, the additional condition that's been agreed with Merseyside Police, the information you've been provided with by Mr. Coley, that this is a premises that you can be satisfied is worthy of this variation, and that you can be assured that were you willing to grant the application, that it will be continue to be run reasonably and responsibly. You've heard that Mr. Coley has sought on occasion advice from Merseyside Police and from Environmental Health and the licensing section, and clearly that is something he would continue to do. He would continue to seek their guidance and react appropriately if issues are to be raised. As members, as you will be aware, if there is any difficulty experienced by any local resident in respect of any licensable activity, they are of course at liberty to make a complaint to the licensing authority, who may then take whatever enforcement action they consider appropriate, and including perhaps a review of the license. So this is certainly not something that the licensed premises would wish to invite, and therefore it is against that background that you can be satisfied that this is an appropriate application and that it is appropriate to allow it this afternoon, unless you have any further questions. But they're my submissions. Sorry, Madam Chair.
Okay, thanks for that, Ms. Ryan. What we're going to do now is this meeting will become private now. We will make a decision today. That decision will be forwarded on to you and Mr. Coley and the residents within the next 5 working days. If for any reason you're not successful, or maybe more conditions may be brought on, you will receive that. But you do have 21 days, Paul.
It is correct, Chair.
21 days to appeal our decision, if that be the case, through the magistrate's court. So what we'll do is you will get it information, you will be informed from us. Is it by email, Anne-Marie, this time? Anne-Marie?
I will send out an email and then I will send out the notice of decision. So I'll do it in two ways.
Can I go with you, Ms. Ryan? Yeah. Mr. Coley, you are happy with that? Okay.
Yes, I am. Yeah, thank you. Yes.
Okay. Okay.
Okay. Go on. Me on the live feed.